include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Welcome to the middle of the African bush. We are on a live safari. Those are elephants, and this is Safari Live. Mobile herd of African elephants. Now what I'm hoping is they're going to move towards some water and might be splishing and a splashing and having mud baths shortly. So we're going to try keep an eye on them. Isn't this wonderful? This is live, and remember, questions at wildearth.tv or hashtag Safari Live if you'd like to ask myself or Taylor any questions. There's Taylor and Dave out on Windy, and of course there's myself, Brent. And my cameraman is Jandre. And Jandre has lost our aerial so far. It has fallen down. So fortunately, it's such a powerful aerial. We're still submitting. Now, those ellies are going to move into some thick, thick bush. But I think they're heading towards a little water. Oh, talking elephants as well. You see the wind's picked up quite a lot. Is that a big ellie bull up ahead? Let's go investigate. So we're going to try to see where these elephants are heading. But isn't this exciting? A live African safari, and off with a bang with one of my favorite creatures out here, the African elephant. Or, if you go down to its scientific name, and most scientific names are a combination of either Latin or ancient Greek. And of course, scientific names are there for a reason. And of course, there's so many diverse languages through the world. And even within areas, animals are called different things. So from a scientific point of view, in the scientific community, they are able to have one name that is used solely, and everyone understands what it is. Now, of course, the elephant is Loxodonta africanum. So that's actually no ancient Greek in there, that's all Latin. And loxa, long, donta, teeth, and africanum, of Africa. Quite an apt scientific description for the African elephant. Okay, those eddies were moving through here, and they were moving quite quickly. So even if we don't catch them right here, I'm pretty confident we're going to catch them around on Weaver's Nest. So while we try to catch up with this nice big herd of elephants, let's go say good afternoon to Taylor.
Hello and welcome to another very windy sunset safari. My name is Taylor, and on camera I've got Davi, or Downpour Dave, as some of you may know him. Now, I know you must have all missed me this morning. I missed you, and I had a lovely lie-in in case you were wondering what I was up to this morning. No, I'm just teasing. Always hard at work here, out in the wilderness. Now, my plan this afternoon is to try and follow up on Karula and her cubs. I believe it was very exciting with Jamie and the unsuspecting wild dogs coming in to come and say hello. Now, we've just managed to find the two-track as to where the sighting apparently is. We're going to go on it and see where it leads us. Now, I haven't been to the sighting just yet. However, I'm very excited because I haven't really seen Karula's cubs just yet. I saw them very briefly after drive one day, but they were up the tree and I couldn't see them properly. But I cannot wait. So we're just bumbling through here, though it's not too thick. It's quite nice and open. Ooh. And oh my goodness, I'm having a sword fight with the aerial, everybody. Don't want to lose an eye. So it's interesting weather that we're having at the moment. It's very hot, very sort of humid weather. I'm just deciding where we go. Let's take this one. There's two loops. And it feels like something is brewing in the air. I'm not sure what is brewing. but something, and hopefully a thunderstorm. Now, the temperature's already changing. It's already a little bit cooler since the last hour. The temperature has dropped quite a bit, which is quite nice. But I'm also just having a little look around here in case I don't miss where these leopards are, because I believe it was quite thick vegetation. So just having it going very slowly through here. Possibly, we've got some guesses. A few of the team members think that we're possibly going to get some rain this evening, which I'm hoping for. Once we're back from drive, however, it would be nice to actually watch the storm build up. And then I think we might get some rain tomorrow, though, or the early hours of the morning. Where are you, leopards? Okay, everybody, so I've gone very quiet, but I am just scanning along this drainage line because this is where Karula was yesterday, and I don't know where it was, so I don't want to have to turn around and come back. We'll just take it nice and easy along here. If you see her, let me know. Right, now this is looking quite familiar from all the footage that I saw. Are you alright? Then we're going to go under some trees. We're good. We've got a big aerial on the back so you can all pick up signal. Right, let me just have a quick look through here. Can't see her just yet. Right, where are you? Don't worry if you hear any banging and clanking. It's just a few small trees, sort of stumps that I think the elephants have taken care of a few years ago. Now I'm just bumping underneath the vehicle. Where are you, leopard? Also just looking for any fresh tire marks, if I can see them going to the edge of the drainage, but I don't see anything just yet. So possibly it's still a little bit further on. I'm probably going to have to ask someone that's already out on drive as to where these leopards were. Goodness gracious, everybody. I need to do a bit of investigating around here. I haven't seemed to find out where they are just yet. But while I do this, let's go see how Brent's elephants are doing.
So we had to stop to do some running repairs, but the amazing thing about the bush is if you stop and look carefully anywhere, you're going to find something interesting. So while we were doing some running repairs, I noticed on this branch here, now this has been made by a wasp. A single female wasp has constructed this massive, so high-rise apartment building for her, for eggs. Now this is really cool, and we don't really find them intact like this too often. So it is disused, the babies have already hatched. So what I'm going to do is I think we probably would like it for the tent. So I'm going to trim the branch a little bit. Okay. I'm trying to be very careful also with this wind, that these can be quite delicate. Let me just get that one out of the way. Ow! That was really sore! Okay. Well, that was being delicate with the wasp nest, but not with my hand. Ow! Okay. So it's actually quite heavy. Now, the reason I know it is no longer in use, I mean, I have to be quite careful with this to get it back intact, is because you can see those holes there. Now, this will be one of the mud dauber wasp species. I'm not 100% sure which one. And let me just jump in the car and I can have a closer look. So what happens is this is now a perfect defensive spot for the little babies to grow up in. But of course, when you're little and you wake up, you're quite hungry. Oops, sorry, that's my head. So when you're little and you wake up and you're quite hungry, so this female wasp, probably looking at the size of this, it could be one of the bigger wasps, bigger wasp species, maybe a spider hunting wasp. They normally bury, but there are species that build like this. So this would have either been filled with little caterpillars or inchworms or spiders or other insects that this wasp had managed to immobilize. She would have laid a single egg in each of those little creatures while they were still alive and then encased them in this. So when her larvae woke up, they have a huge, massive buffet, and they'll eat through those, and that'll enable them to get enough strength to burrow out of the mud and then take off. Now, looking at this mud, I even know where it comes from. Now, it's also where we are. We're very close to the treehouse waterhole, and I think before the rains, oh, so delicate, I'll find my jersey to put it in so we don't break it. And James will be quite excited to see this when he gets back. Here we go. Okay, very delicately put there. So I think it's from the treehouse waterhole, which is just ahead. Now, it has put us a little bit behind those eddies. We'll see if we can catch up with them. But it is really amazing that everywhere you look, there is something amazing. Oh, wind's picking up again. It's been quite a topsy-turvy day in terms of temperature and weather. Started off very warm and humid with a few raindrops this morning. And it got really hot during the middle of the day. Maybe went up to about 90 Fahrenheit. Now it's dropped down. We're probably just below 90, sort of 85 to 88. And I was hoping those elephants might cut through towards treehouse, but they haven't. So we're going to go check down towards Weaver's Nest. So we've got those wonderful deep indentations here that water seeps through at the treehouse waterhole. So that's, I think, while it was so dry, where this wasp managed to extract mud from. There you go, you can see them. They were dug by elephants. And so there's a natural movement of water under the ground there. And I think that's how this wasp was able to get enough mud, even during the very dry period, to build this incredible enclosure for its babies. Those elephants were moving southeast. Now, of course, there's that wonderful bunch of pans and water holes around Chele Pan and Spaghetti Junction, that area. Now, I've really been looking forward to seeing some elephants play in the mud. Okay, so we're going to speed up a little bit, try catch up with those eddies, and while we do that, it seems like Taylor has arrived in the last position of a very elusive cat.
We have found the carcass. However, there are no leopards here. Not that I can see. Oh, hang on, maybe I can see a leopard. I can see a leopard, everybody. David, I don't think you're going to be able to see it. Everyone, I just want to try and explain to David. You see the big tree behind where the kill is?
Yeah.
There's a leopard just sitting to the left. Let me go forward a little bit. I don't think we're going to see her very well. She's behind lots of trees. Can you see the face? Very, very hard to see the yeah, there we go. Straight. There. Can you see just to that thing over there? Yeah, you can see the leopard, everybody. And now I presume that that is Karula because it looks quite big. Fantastic. Now we can see some movement, so it seems as though she's grooming herself. Now, big yawn. And then she rolled over. That's a bit rude, don't you think? No, come on, come and show us how you're going to feast on this almighty kill. Now, the carcass is starting to smell a little bit, everybody. Not bad, though. It's not unpleasant just yet. So I'm very happy that we managed to see her. Because when we arrived, I couldn't see anything. There was absolutely nothing here. So I think she was laying flat on that bank. But now she's got her head up. Now, I don't know how long she's going to keep her head up for. Possibly it was just because we came through here and she heard a bit of noise and maybe she thought we were going to try and steal her kill. I'm not sure what's on Karula's brain today. But I am going to be optimistic and hope that she comes towards us, which will be quite exciting. And I'm so envious of Jamie this morning, but I'm also so happy for her that she got to see such an amazing interaction as those wild dogs came chasing through. That's quite phenomenal. That's really special when you get to see something like that. And then I love the fact that Karula went in and grabbed the little leftover carcass. I think it was an inyala. And then took it up the tree. But I think that they've eaten that because I can see. Can you see that little small bit of spine or something just sitting lower down on the branch?
Yeah.
I think that's the leftover or what was left of the inyala. So it looks like they've maybe devoured the last little bit. And possibly the cubs are with her on the other side of this big bank as well. Now, Aubrey's also going to come through. And Aubrey's going to come along the southern end of the bank, so where Karula is sitting. So we'll see. If he says that it's a great visual, then we will definitely go around that way. But I'm also quite reluctant, because if she has got her head up and she has been yawning, she did give herself a little groom, we all know this, so that's an indication that she's possibly going to wake up and maybe come and feed again, or maybe go for a drink of water. So we will just be a little bit patient. There's nothing worse than going around and repositioning for her to only get up and walk down the other side of the bank again. And you saw when we came moving through and you saw how Jamie has been struggling and all the other guides to try and actually get a look at her. It's very thick here. It's quite tricky terrain. Oh, here we go. She looks like she's moving a little bit. Come towards us. It's very hot today, everybody. I can't explain. It's uncomfortable. Normally, it's just a very hot heat, dry heat. But today, it's extremely humid. And that's why I think that we're going to hopefully get some rain either tonight or tomorrow morning. But not during safari time. So let's hope for the rain to be in between either while we are all resting or perhaps during game drives. I like coming out. We all like spending time with these wonderful animals. It's amazing though. You look through here. I can't believe that I saw her through all of these branches and things. There we go. Another big yawn. You can see the flies are also bothering her quite a bit. And typically on these hot, humid days, the flies are terrible, particularly terrible. But she's panting to try and cool herself down. I just want to quickly tell Aubrey that I have got a visual of Karula, so if you can just give me one moment. Aubrey Taylor. Aubrey Taylor. Ooh, she's getting up. Aubs, I've got visual of Karula, but she is on the southern end of the bank. So I think come around and you'll probably get visual of her. I'm going to hang tight on the northern side. Can hear Aubrey's vehicle now coming through. But she's looking more and more awake now. So perhaps she has been resting most of the day. And like I said, the temperature has definitely dropped a few degrees Fahrenheit in the last hour. And the wind is starting to pick up. At one point today, it was extremely uncomfortable because there wasn't even a breeze. And in that high humidity, it wasn't fun. I'm not 100% sure what the humidity levels was, but it felt like more than about 60%. So it was quite warm and sticky. Come on, Karula, bring your cubs this way. We want to see them. I haven't seen them yet. She's just looking around. I can hear Aubrey's vehicle coming through. I think they do have a better view that side. But I'll just wait for Aubrey to give me the go-ahead. Now I'm tossing and turning. I don't know what I should do, if I should. Let's give it another 2 or 3 minutes waiting here and see if she does anything. And if she doesn't, then I think we will make the long route around and try and get a better shot of her. But you know what, if she does come here, we've got a perfect view. If she were to climb the tree and feed on that bush buck, it'll be amazing. So that's also the thing, I don't want to give up because we've got the best spot in that sense. But we will give it a few minutes. Patience, everybody, patience is a virtue. It is, there's nothing truer in the bush. Remember, everybody, we are on a live safari, so if you have any questions, you are welcome to chat to myself or Brent, and you can either do that by asking your questions on Twitter and then adding the hashtag SafariLive, or you are welcome to send us an email if you don't have Twitter. The email address is questions@wildearth.tv, and I look forward to hearing some of you. So we're sitting with Karula at the moment. If you perhaps just started watching a little bit later than you normally do, maybe you're making a cup of coffee or something, but it's okay. Karula's testing our patience today, so you haven't missed too much. And we haven't seen any sign of the cubs just yet, but we're waiting. You can just see the spots hiding between all the trees. But I think they even possibly have an obstructed view too, because I'm just trying to see, there's quite a lot of trees surrounding her. She's got herself a nice little thicket, and I can hear their vehicle moving again, so perhaps they're all having to have opportunities to view this leopard row by row. I don't think it's ideal. But there's not many leaves on all of these trees, and it was, like I said, it's been extremely hot today, so she would have needed to find some shelter to rest underneath, to try and avoid that horrible heat and also to try and avoid the flies. But I think it's a good little spot that she's got. Not great for us, but at least you can say you saw a leopard today. Half a leopard. That could actually just be one of the wonderful ladies in Final Control in a leopard suit laying there. Everybody, I'm going to just sit here for a little bit longer, and perhaps by the time you get back to me, I would have repositioned. Let's go to Brent for a little update.
I'm doing splendidly. I've found some more elephants. And these guys have already been a splishing and a splashing. I've missed my elephant mud bath again. Hello, little man. Don't you look very dark with all the mud on you? So we're in the dry riverbed, and it's called the Mawati. And so far I can just see two, and there's probably a few more about. Nice big cow at the back. It's going to come out into view shortly. There she is. Getting stuck into that very thorny knob thorn. Closest to us is actually looking for grass that's growing underneath all that fallen vegetation there. You can see the green in his mouth there that he's picking from between all the dry dead branches. To sniff out the tastiest morsels. And look how tiny those little things he's feeding off on. That's how incredibly dexterous they look, these chunkies. Hey, little man, young bull, probably around 4 or 5 years old. Doing a good job at mowing the lawn. Amazing eating machines. Even though they're... Ooh! Man, we gotta carry on, but... Karina's come out into the open and she's looking for the babies.
Finally, Karula has awoken, and I have to say thank you to Rebecca and Louise and Final Control for singing a nice song about Karula, which encouraged her to get up this afternoon. But look at this, isn't this incredible? She's going to jump right up. I'm so happy. Wow, look at the power as she jumped up that tree. She didn't even put any effort into that. It's incredible. Now, patience is a virtue, everybody, like I said. That is amazing, everybody. Take a few screenshots of her up in that tree, especially when she looks over the branch at you. It's a nice creative shot. And she was also calling for her cubs, and it seems as though her cubs could possibly be north of us somewhere. So I'm also looking over my shoulder consistently, just trying to see when they're going to pop out. Come on, girl, make your move. Oh wow, look at that. Unbelievable. Did you see all the flies? Wow, he's right above us, everybody. This is very cool, but don't worry, we're safe. Don't need to worry about David and I. Isn't this amazing? This is really special, everybody. I'm wondering, it's going to be very difficult to try and see her face, but let's sort of pluck the hair a little bit and get comfortable before I try and reposition. Just having a little look. Could possibly go a little bit further. We do have a bit of a drop, but we can try. This is quite spectacular. And I'm so happy that she was quite relaxed with us sitting here. I was wondering if I was going to perhaps have to move away. But I think the fact that we held our position and we didn't move around at all, it just shows that she's very, very happy with us. Because I know she can be a little bit feisty, especially in such a tight quarters like this. Now, it's hard for you to hear, but I can hear her actually plucking the hair. And you can almost see some of the hair dropping as she pulls it out. There still seems to be quite a bit of meat left on this bushbuck. So perhaps they'll still be here tomorrow morning. Well, it depends if her little greedy gutses come in and eat it all. Then maybe they'll be finished tonight. You see all those flies that have been hanging around. See how she's shaking her head now? Got a bit of fluff stuck in her mouth. Now, good afternoon, Jason. Thank you so much for watching the show, and I hope you're enjoying this amazing moment with Karula. Now, Jason was asking, how far away would those cubs go from Karula, and would it be possible that they go for a drink on their own? Now, Jason, I think they're a little bit young still to just go off on their own to have a drink. I know yesterday afternoon you saw it with me with those lion cubs coming out and having a drink, but the adults were quite close. They were about 50 meters away, so they weren't far at all. So I'm not sure exactly how far Galago Pan is from here. I don't think it's too far, but it's a bit risky. It's very thick. It's not quite sort of out in the open. And I think Mom would never let them wander off. So I reckon they're within 100 meters or so. In the area, maybe even closer. I haven't seen them. She keeps looking behind us and calling, so perhaps she got sick of them today. That's often what we see, where they bite and they get a bit too much, and Mom wants to do is have a rest, and she'll often take them somewhere, drop them, tell them, you stay there for a little bit and I'll call you when you can come for dinner. I think that's possibly the case. Now, I must tell you a story, though. So there was and I think I've told the story about this leopard before, Lisbon, who was Queen of the South, in the southern sector of the southwestern corner of the Sabi Sands. And she was interesting. She's a lovely leopard, very calm, but her cub that she had, unfortunately, he was not very relaxed until he got a bit older. And she used to call and call for 20, 30, 40 minutes at a time. And this cub would come running out from miles away. It was quite amazing. So it is possible for Mom to stash a cub quite a distance away and then carry on. But that little one knew it had to stay put and not go too far. But it didn't like to respond when Mom called it. And it seems like Karula's cubs are doing the same thing. They don't want to listen. But maybe they're quite strategic, these young cubs. Maybe they're waiting for Mom to dehair this bushbuck, and then they're maybe going to come through after that. Very clever, then they don't have to do any of the hard work. They've just got to come and eat. What do you think, David, if I maybe go back a little bit?
That'd be great.
Okay, right, everyone, I'm going to very quickly reposition. So just bear with me for 2 seconds. Ooh, come on, Wendy. Yeah, we're going to go back. And she's still very calm. She's not bothered by us at all, which is fantastic. This is amazing. There we go. I'm going to make sure that there's enough space for the other vehicle to have a look too. I think that's all right, and I'm sure that they will squeeze in. Now we can see her head, everybody. And we can watch what she's doing. We're getting covered in bushbuck here, everybody. It's raining down on us. But she's pulling all that hair out. Seems like they've eaten her back legs. Quite a bit of it. Oh, no, she didn't like that. There you go. You can see all that hair dropping from her mouth. Ugh. Bless you. I would also sneeze if I had a mouthful. You can even see a tuft of hair on the side of her right side of her face. There we go. Look at all those flies. That's all on that stick. That is terrible. I just think it's incredible how animals don't mind the flies as much, but I would die. I couldn't do that. Now, looking at the tree that she's in a tamboti, everybody. Now, it looks very, very high, doesn't it? Now, I know Connie was wondering how high we are off the ground. It's not that bad, actually. She's in a tree that's growing from the side of a bank. I reckon she's probably about 4 meters off the ground, maybe 4.5 meters. Ooh. So not that high. I mean, I've seen leopards that are 5 or 6, even maybe even higher, on the tip tops of trees. Remember that day when that young female lioness chased Tingana up the tree? He was standing right on the tippy top. He must have been almost 10 meters up. What has she got there? She's got the tail. Very special. See how she's just looking around? Possibly she's going to give a little call. No. Thought she was maybe going to look up and call again for her cubs. Well, I think we're going to hang around for a little bit. Doesn't seem like there's too much pressure on the sighting, which is great for us. So let's jump on the back of Brent's vehicle.
That's a gorgeous, gorgeous tawny eagle. And look at that massive hooked bill. That is a rapier-like talent. Now, as we drove up, it was on the ground. And we'll have a look now. We're not sure what it caught. Initially, I thought maybe a scrub hare. But now, we might even think it might be a tiny baby steenbok. Let's try to have a closer look. So the eagle's a little bit away. I'm just going to drive off the road ever so slightly so we can have a look what that is. I don't want to get too close. I don't want to steal that eagle's meal, although I'm very confident he's going to come back as soon as we move. It's just, unfortunately for him, right next to the main road. If we just get a little bit higher, we might be able to see. How's that, Chandra? There we go. Not getting too close. The eagle's still okay. What is it? I do see a little hoof. It is a baby steenbok. Isn't that incredible? Okay, we're gonna move away now. So that eagle can come back and get its hard worked for kill. But that's incredible. So that baby steenbok would have actually been sort of just lying normally undercover when no one can see it. Maybe something spooked the little steenbok and enabled that eagle to see it and swoop down. So there we go. It's going to move a bit further away from the carcass so the eagle feels a bit more relaxed. Eagle. Isn't that spectacular? Now, the main reason I know it's a tawny eagle, let's just turn your head towards us. There we go. Now, the gape, which is its mouth, when he turns his head sideways. Now, a steppe eagle and a tawny eagle can look very, very similar. But this is a tawny. Now, when he has his head sideways like that, you see the gape goes to about halfway through the eye. Now, with a steppe eagle, the gape extends beyond the eye. Okay, so let's leave this eagle alone so he can go back to eating its meal. While we do that, we're going to start heading towards Cheetah Plains. See what adventures are waiting for us down in the east. So let's go back to Taylor and Karuna.
It sounds like she is now eating biltong. And if you watch, every now and then she pulls off a couple of pieces that have dried in this lovely weather that we've been having, this hot weather. There we go, a big chunk of biltong. She obviously likes her biltong rare. Now, you hear me talking about biltong. Biltong is a South African delicacy. It's usually dried meat of any sort, typically beef. But we do it with the antelope as well. And now we can really smell the carcass as she's... Oh, wow, can you hear the crunching? Mm-hmm. Listen to that. Oh my goodness, wow. She obviously didn't get taught any table manners, I'm afraid. And she's crunching away, chewing with her mouth wide open. But we don't mind, we get to see those lovely teeth of hers. You see how she keeps staring like that in the distance? So I presume that's where the cubs are. They must be down there somewhere. But she keeps looking over in the same spot all the time. We are so lucky. Can you hear the flies as well as they're buzzing around? There's so many of them. And I cannot believe the balancing act that Karula is doing at the moment. She's got her legs spread out, balancing one on either branch. Can't see it too well. And then she's managing to use one paw to hold onto the carcass. It's quite amazing how they're able to do all of those things and keep it up in the tree. Look at her biting down. So she doesn't seem to be doing the sort of carnassial shear at the moment. Looks like she's biting on the spine itself. On the neck vertebrae, perhaps. It's pretty, yes, it looks a bit. Maybe even on the sternum, so sort of the chest bone. It's a bit difficult to see with the way that she's twisting and turning the carcass, but when she lifts it up, I think perhaps it's maybe the... Her chest bone, that's what she's biting on, trying to get the meat off. Here we go, now she's trying to go in for that carnassial shear. Come on. Wow, and it's lovely golden light that's coming through as well. Remember to take snapshots, everybody. Now, it seems to be quite amazing that we can just sit here and watch this leopard feed in a tree without us really having any impact on her. Now, Zaki was wondering exactly that. Zaki was wanting to know, how on earth are we able to interact with these animals? So I'm not putting it in exactly the same words. How are we able to interact with these animals and the animals don't realize that we are, could potentially be a threat to her and her cubs? And that's, Zaki, there's no hunting or anything that goes on here. So we as humans, we come around in these big vehicles and we just observe. So the only shooting we're doing is with the cameras. That's it. Now, it's taken many, many, many years for them to become accustomed to us. It's taken almost over 30 years of interactions and basically we're habituating the animals, but just to the vehicles. Now, if I were to get out of the vehicle now, she would be very upset. Firstly, she's got an advantage point because she's above us. And secondly, she's on a kill. She's going to act very aggressively towards me. And we won't do that, though. We all keep in our vehicles and in this particular area. Is why you have experienced guides taking you around if you are fortunate to come to the Sabi Sands and do a safari here. Yes, everybody's very well trained. So we can read their behavior quite well. And if it were, Zaki, that it seemed as though that female felt a bit threatened by us and she showed us some aggression signs, if it's possible, or well, I'd move away completely and just say we can come back another time. She's obviously not feeling our vibe. She feels a bit threatened. And that's how you should do it. We do it a lot, especially with animals like elephants. When they show that they're unhappy with us, we move away completely. There we go. She's got a nice chunk of meat now. She didn't even have to pull that off. It's so soft there. Now those cubs better come quickly, because she's, Karula's eating all the prime bits. And I'm still just checking around, looking over my shoulder, seeing if I can spot the little spotted cats, but I can't just yet. Oh, I can! Oh my goodness! There is one coming up behind us. I don't know if you're going to be able to see. You see where this big tall tree is? To the left. I don't think you can. Maybe. Here we go. Go straight. Go down. Go down. Go to the right. No, I think it's just behind the tree for you. If I go forward slightly, we can change that view. Let me go forward. Got one of the cubs, but I can't see which one it is just yet. That's not good. Sorry, everybody. Wendy's playing games with me. Can you see there now? I think it's going to be difficult. Go a little bit to the right again. Left, sorry, not right. Oh, my goodness. Go up. There. You can just see the nose. Very difficult. But there is one of the cubs. Now, I wonder why Karula keeps looking off into the distance and calling the opposite way. Maybe she forgot where she left her cubs. I can't tell you exactly who this is. I'm afraid we've got a very, very little visual of this one. But we'll see. It looks quite big. Quite a broad face from what I can sort of see. But possibly it's going to be Hosanna. And hopefully Shongile will be close to follow. Now, if it is him, he keeps staring over at Mom, as if he was waiting for her to say, right, it's okay, you can come along now. But nothing just yet. Remember to take lots of screenshots, everybody. So that's exciting. At least they're looking good. They're looking still looking well fed. Now we've actually got an even better angle of this female. Remember to take screenshots, everybody. I can't stress this enough, because sightings like this don't come around all the time. There's bound to be the days where we're not going to see too much. So make the most of all the wonderful cats, especially while we've got all this dry weather about. All the animals are feeling very stressed, very hungry, and it's a prime opportunity for all the predators to flourish. But when the rains come, the tables are going to turn, the green grass is going to come, and all the herbivores are going to be able to eat their fill and regain their strength. It's also quite difficult for the predators to hide in the green grass. They stand out a little bit more. I can see she's broken off a part of this bushbuck, and you can hear her crunching a little bit there. Now, Kathy, I know you were wondering if a Karula eats the bone or does she spit them out. If it's the smaller bits of bone, she'll actually digest them. However, they don't just digest bone very well like hyenas do. The hyenas have got fantastic, strong stomach acids that are able to digest shards of bone. Where's she going to go and stash this? It looks like you're going to eat it there. Maybe a bit easier for her to balance. Sorry, Kathy. So she'll eat those little bones that you saw. That's no problem for her to digest. But a hyena can digest bone shards of up to 9 centimeters in length. So that's really, really big. But unfortunately, Karula is unable to do that. So she'll eat around the big bones. You can hear that crunching quite nicely. Now, where did Hosanna go to? Sorry, I'm just having a look again over my shoulder. Window. I took my eyes off of Hosanna for one moment, and now he's disappeared. Perhaps he's gone back up the mound again. Wow. This is amazing. The light, the clouds are sort of opened up a little bit as well, creating those nice bits of golden light coming through the trees. It's quite special. Remember, if you're taking any snapshots, remember to hashtag SafariLive, or you can email them. These are incredible pictures, everybody, to be able to see a leopard now in full view, sitting up on this beautiful tamboti tree. It's very nice, and the light is much better than what it was earlier. I mean, how's that? It doesn't get any better than that, I'm afraid. So you hear me snapping a few pictures as well. It's hard to pass up an opportunity like this. Wow. See, she's licking it now, trying to find another chunk of flesh to tear off. Just having a look again to see if I can see where the cubs went. Nope. Wow. Also getting an opportunity to see her lovely teeth as well. So it's quite fascinating how they eat all this flesh and all these rotting things occasionally, and they still manage to have relatively clean teeth without having to brush them like you and I. But you can see those canines are a little bit blunt on top there. It just shows that she's aging. That's quite normal. It's the first thing it goes, obviously, as an animal gets older. Same as humans, your teeth start to wear down. But they're still nice and big. She can still do her job. Is she looking around? Call your cubs again. They want to come. There we go. Wow. This is why, everybody, I have the best job in the world. Anybody that lives in the bush. Ooh, big crunches there. See how she doesn't let the bone get stuck in her throat. Now, I don't know if you've ever tried this, or if you've got dogs at home and you don't feed, or you didn't feed your dogs bones as from a young age. And it's quite amazing to see how you start feeding them bones later in life, and sometimes they don't quite know what to do. And we had one dog, we had an Irish wolfhound. We used to give big bones to occasionally. Like, I mean, when I say big bones, you'd go to the butcher and they'd, you know, give you the female of a cow or something like that, something along those lines. So really, really big bones that they can gnaw on. And she ate it, and there were lots of little bones, little shards of bone coming off. And she actually ended up getting one wedged in the roof of her palate. And I'm pretty sure that was just from inexperience, not really having bones her entire life. And I think it's quite phenomenal how we don't often see the animals with lots of bones stuck in their mouth. I've seen young leopard that are inexperienced and don't quite know how to feed around them, get the occasional one stuck in their mouths, but the adults are so good at finding all the best ways to get all the flesh off without injuring themselves. And that bone can be sharp, especially when she crunches it. I'm sure there's lots of sharp bits there. Look at the light as it's catching her eyes. That is amazing. Watch as I aim my camera to her. Oh, what have you seen? See how she's looking like that? Just looking in the distance to try and figure out what she's looking at. Don't see anything just yet, but her eyesight is much better than mine is. And we're also sitting down in this drainage now. No, she doesn't seem too bothered by it anymore. Perhaps she heard something. And she was just focusing both her ears as well as her eyes. You see? I just want to show you something very quickly. I've got a pair of citrus swallowtail butterflies, and they look like they're quite keen to mate. Look at this. I know I'm taking you away from Karula very quickly. But these are beautiful butterflies. There they go. They're quite quick and they're relatively big. But now, off they go. It's hard to keep on there, but you got a very quick view of a lovely citrus swallowtail, which is one of the most amazing butterflies in the bush. And I think it was Joanne was wondering if the cubs are still suckling. I'm not 100% sure how old the cubs are, but they look relatively large. Oh, there, one has come back again. And I reckon they look to be about 7 months old, maybe 6 or 7 months old. They're quite big. Just the same, go straight in again. There we go, up. We go up again. No, why can't you see it now? It's just on the, I think it's just behind, okay. Sorry everyone, we can't show you the cubs, the just behind that tree. One has come back again, which is great for us. Now, Joanne, so I presume that they're not suckling anymore. I think they're completely eating meat, but I just need to confirm their age. But it's the same thing with lions. Normally around 5 or 6 months, they're getting weaned. And they're starting to mainly just feed solids. I think Karula's now just seen that other cub. Yes, they're here, but I don't know why they don't want to come to you. Call them. Ah, thank you, Louise. Louise says that the cubs are going to be about 8 months old on the 2nd of October. Very nice, date specific. So they have definitely been weaned, and they're just feeding on the carcasses that mom manages to catch with them. Now, if I was a hyena, and I did see some fresh hyena tracks going up a shortcut Galago, I would be waiting here because Karula's been dropping lots of scraps. There's a tail on the ground. There's a little, I don't know, can you, I don't think you can see down there. Can you see? There we go, there's the tail. And if you go to the left, there's a little scrap that she's just dropped now. And these would be lovely, tasty morsels for the hyena. Oh, here comes the cub. Yay! Go on, join mum. This is turning out to be a fantastic afternoon once again. Down poor Dave, bringing all the luck. Oh my God. It is amazing. Ooh, 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 ooh. What's happening? Look at this interaction. Hello. Yes, I've been looking for you. Oh, wow. Hello, Mom. Thank you so much for all the lovely food that you catch for me. Oh, very clumsy. Yes, it does look like this is Hosanna. Very much look like a boy. I did just get a quick glimpse as he ran up and lifted his tail. Now we are short one more. Come on, call for your other one. Trying to get comfy. Oh, bless you. Not quite as confident as Mom is in the tree. Hang on, maybe you're not. Let's see. Oh, she's. Her mom's coming down now. Karula's on her way. I think she's going to look for the other one. She's sort of doing a little bit of a groaning sound. I think it's a bit too far away for you to see. I'm also just trying to double check to see if this is Hosanna. Now, can we maybe zoom in on his rear end? I know this is not the best. No, no, we can't see it at all. Never mind. We'll get an opportunity. But he should start developing testicles. We should start to see that. All those flies flying away there, covering the carcass. Soon there's going to be maggots all over this carcass. I wouldn't like to stand under the tree with a carcass in it that's filled with maggots. It'll just rain maggots. Oh, careful. Getting too excited about eating and not really watching where you put your foot could be a big mistake. Here we go, we're going to be able to tell now. Oh, I think it actually, I don't know if it is. I think this could possibly be Shongile. I didn't see testicles now, and she in this one. Did you see testicles?
No.
I didn't see testicles. I didn't see a little bulge, unfortunately. So maybe it is Shongile. But can you just sit still for just a few minutes with your bum facing up? Okay. So Louise is saying that this is definitely Hosanna, but shame. Maybe he's a bit slow on the development side. Uh-oh, that's a thin branch that you're on there. No, that's very brave. David, can you have a show everybody, show all the lovely viewers out there how small that branch is? Look at that, it's like a tightrope act. Very, very flexible. I'd be careful. You're going to fall out the tree or you're going to drop the carcass and Mum is not going to be very impressed with you if you do that. And that just shows you where the inexperience is. And this is the problem that Mom has to worry about all the time, is she spends most of the, well, quite a bit of effort trying to get that carcass up a tree, and she wedges it in nicely, and she manages to eat and tug on it and break bits of bone off, and no problem. When the little one's cub come through, they get a bit excited, as we just saw, and they start pulling and dragging, don't know where to put their feet. And then they could lose it. Possibly some hyenas will come through tonight. That would be fantastic. Like I said, there's lots of scraps for them on the ground waiting. Got a nice bit of flesh there munching away. They're getting big though. I'm gonna have to just jump on the radio in a few moments, because I know there's another vehicle that would like to come and join. So let me just chat to Mike very quickly. Mike Taylor, you're more than welcome to make your approach. Okay, while I while I try and control this leopard sighting very quickly, Brent has got another spotted cat on Cheetah Plains.
Sorry about that, there he is. He's across our boundary, unfortunately, but it is Mr. Q. Let me just try find you another, let me just go forward a skosh. Sorry about all the when we start the car. But he is, how's that, Chandra? There we go. Okay, so it is quarantine. I know, a firm favorite of a lot of you. And I have heard that over there somewhere, he's killed one of the rarest antelopes in the Sabi Sands. He has caught a reed buck. I don't know if he's put the kill in a tree, I can't really see, but let's watch where he goes. He is definitely one of my favorite cats. And when I started at Safarilive, we were lucky enough to spend an incredible amount of time with him and his brother. Yeah, I'm just going to wait to see if... Jean-Pierre, I want to have a look in that tree over there. There's a big marula. It looks like that might be a carcass on the branch. So just to the right of where we were looking. Let me just go back. Sorry. No, I can't see any. A little bit to the right. No, I think it's just a crisscrossing of branches. Okay, he's moving past that vehicle. Let's go forward. Oh. no, I'm going to have to go back. Hi, Susan. Susan is wondering why he's called quarantine. And that's not because he was in quarantine like Sindile. So what happened is after he became independent from his mother, and you've seen his mother today, it's Karula. He spent an incredible amount of time on an open area, which is just behind the Juma Lodge. And that area is called the quarantine clearings. Unfortunately, I think we're not going to see much more of a quarantine in a clearing as he moves deeper into Incoral. So, you see him, Jono? He's to the right behind the vehicle. And went to the there, and he was moving through there. So, unfortunately, we can't see where the carcass is. And it looks like he's not, it might not be in a tree yet. But anyway, always nice to know that he's doing well. And he's got himself some meat to eat, a young quarantine. So Susan, as I was saying, so there's this big open area where we have fireside chats right behind the Juma lodges, and that is called quarantine. So back in the 50s, it was a quarantine area for cattle, and he just spent so much time in those clearings and around the edge of those clearings that that's how he got his name. Now, I came dashing down to Cheetah Plains because I heard the report of another spotted cat, the cheetah. But it looks like they've already crossed Cheetah Plains and are on their way to Torchwood. Now, I have some very, very interesting news. And it is a combination news. So there's good news and there's bad news. So you let me know, what do you want to hear first, the bad news or the good news? Hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv. What do you want to hear first, the good news or the bad news? No crowned lapwings. They're quite happy that there's been some rain, there's some more insects out there for them to hunt down. You see that very distinct white crown. Well, lapwing's keeping Gendre on his toes. Now, after this green flash, I'm hoping to find another bird of the short grass plains. One I've only seen once on the live drives, and that, whoa, right, hovering right next to us is a Temix acorsa. Okay, bye lapwings. Oh, that one got one, he's got something. He just caught something in the road. Oh, he swallowed it already, greedy guts. Off they go. Oh, they're having a little battle. Whoa, nice work, Chandra. So that looks like two males fighting over this little patch of open ground. And they're incredibly quick, as you can see. Chandra is doing a sterling job keeping up with them as they battle through the sky. Oh, he sidestepped Chandra. Here we go. Oh, and they're using the wind as well, which is making it those drops and falls even quicker. Okay, let's stop torturing Gendre. Oh, there we go. They're going to stop torturing Gendre and land. And let's carry on towards the Cheetah Plains path. Okay, so it sounds like everyone would like to hear the bad news first and then the good news. So the bad news is I can confirm 100% now, because I've heard various different reports about the stick cubs. There are only two left. Not one, not four, not three, but two. So one of the older ones and one of the younger ones. And that is the bad news. There are only two of those cubs left. But the good news. Jandre, do you know you don't know the good news. So I heard the good news in my ear. And am I going to tell you this? I'm going to keep it for a little bit. No, let's tell you. Okay, so the oldest Styx female has been given birth to new cubs. Yay! So it is what happens out here. As soon as she had lost cubs, she would have produced more. So apparently she gave birth. They found the den. They're not sure how many cubs are there yet. As soon as I hear, I'll let you know. And they're about estimated about 2 weeks old, so still really, really tiny. And she has used the Mawati River as a den site again, but below Juma, so outside of our traverse area. Okay, so there we go, good news. Okay, we're coming up to the open plains. Not a wildly beast or zebra in sight. Of course, I always like checking in on my mate Gnominus Gnome in the Gnu. But he normally chills out a bit further to the south. Now, we've seen one of Karula's adult children today, and I know you've seen one of her current set of children, so let's go look at the other.
So Hosanna over here is having an absolute field day, as you can see. Oh wow, that's beautiful. And pulling this bushbuck all over the show, grabbing it by the head, dragging it up, trying to reposition it. All careful, don't fall. Wow, putting on an absolute show for us, and now for you too, that you're back with us. And that's another leopard I haven't seen, or I believe you got a quick glimpse of, which was Quarantine. And I believe he's a beautiful boy, and also the offspring of Karula. So that's very nice. So I'm going to have to keep my ears open, perhaps for tomorrow morning, and maybe I'll be able to go around that side just to have a look and see if I don't get an opportunity to see him. It's nice to be taking a little break from the lions. We all absolutely love the lions, but we love the leopards too. And the leopards have been a bit shy the last few days, so the more we can see, the better. Now, you are hiding your face from us. Bring your face over. There we go. Just sneaking an eye. That's awesome. Very nice. Now, while we weren't with you, we had some Inyala and Impala sneak past the back of the vehicle, and they did so very quietly that Karula only caught them as they were disappearing off into the thicket, and she looked very keen and very interested, but then she decided nope, she was going to let it go, and then she sat down again. Now she's just watching over the area, watching her little one eat, and we're still waiting for Shongile to come around. I think you can see Karula very nicely there. Good afternoon, Heather from Minnesota. So, you're wanting to know this afternoon, do big cats have taste buds? I'm not 100% sure. And you made a very good point there. You say, how can they go and eat on a fresh carcass and then come back a few days later or find a rotting carcass and feed on that? Now, I don't think they possibly have taste buds like we as humans have taste buds, where we have a taste buds sweet that pick up either sweet and salty or sour. I think it's slightly different. I'm going to have to do quite a bit of research about that. I haven't ever read anywhere about big cats' taste buds, so that was a fantastic question, Heather, and I will get back to you. So keep watching. Possibly tomorrow morning, once I've had an opportunity to do a bit of research, I shall let you know. So make sure that you're watching, and then you can hear the answer. But like I said, I don't think it's quite like our taste buds. I think very much different. But with them being able to feed on rotting meat, that doesn't really have too much to do with their taste buds. That's just got to do with their stomach acids and the fact that they're able to digest a variety of different meats. and that the rotting stuff doesn't bother them too much. We would probably die if we had to go and eat on a 4-day-old carcass. We definitely have a bacterial infection that I don't think the hospitals could even save us. Some foul bacteria that starts to form on the carcass. Imagine eating all the fly eggs. Oh, no. This light is just beautiful now. So speaking of all the different flies and larvae, we know that they get lots of ectoparasites, but what parasites affect them inside their bodies? And Kathy wants to know, do the big cats die from tapeworms like domestic cats can? I'm sure they can. If they get an infestation of worms, and particularly a tapeworm, which is the nasty one, I definitely think that they could die from something like that. But it would have to be a serious infestation. Look at that leg. Struggling, every now and then struggling to find a spot for his foot. I'm just going to zoom in quickly, everybody, and see something. Such amazing light. I can't get over it. Oh, no, you, oh my goodness, facing right towards us now, that bushback's head. No, it's not going to go over there, I'm afraid. Oh, what was that? Maybe another vehicle? Just heard a branch cracking. Yes, I think it could possibly be another vehicle because I can see Hosanna's looking over in the distance. It's just a bit windy, so it's muffling the sound quite a bit. I can't really hear what's on the other side or see what's on the other side of this bank. Copy. Thanks, Mike. I'm down in the drainage. Mike's just joined us. And I can just see the big smiles of all his guests. They must be so excited. Possibly it's their first safari and they've never seen a leopard. What a way to start your day if you're coming on safari. And for those of you who don't get the opportunity to come out to South Africa, at least you've got us here on Safari Live to spend every single day watching these beautiful animals from the comfort of your home. But I suspect Karula and Hosanna have eaten away quite a bit. I think they might finish this quite soon. I'm just trying to have a look at Karula again. You can see her just lounging out, spread out. She's got her belly nice and full and still quite warm. Now poor Karula is having to hunt for obviously two cubs. It can be quite tiring having to worry about hunting, not just for yourself, but for your cubs too. And Rob, good afternoon. I know that you were wondering, at what age are Karula's cubs going to attempt to make their first kill? And what do I think they're going to hunt for the first time? Now, Mom is going to start bringing back some of these antelope that she's catching. And she's not going to quite kill them properly. She's going to bring them back half-killed so that these youngsters can learn how to suffocate. Now, I've seen it a few times with leopards when they've done this. And the cubs have been close by. I actually saw it with one of the leopards called Little Bush down in the southern sector of the Sabi Sands with her cub, but she hasn't got a name just yet. She's also actually about their age, maybe a little bit older, where she caught a steenbok. And she didn't really kill it. She just held it by the throat and she walked with it. Obviously, a steenbok is quite a small antelope. And brought it back to the den site and then let the little one actually play with it and suffocate it, which was quite amazing to watch. So I reckon they're going to start paying a lot of interest in all the little birds that we see. So from the crested franklins, that's going to be a good thing, and guinea fowl, to try and learn to hunt and have a bit of fun and a bit of practice. But if they can learn to catch something like a steenbok to start off with, that'd be great. Something small, something easy. think it'll be a bit too much for them if they try and go for something like a big impala ram. I think that's a bit out of their sort of skill range. Perhaps something small. And hopefully we get to see some of that. Yesterday afternoon it was quite nice. We were watching the lions and they're finally starting to show some interest in the birds. We saw them stalking some turtle doves. So perhaps we're going to start seeing things like that. Or even if they do spot a herd of impala and they just sort of run towards it and just learn from experience that no, you have to stalk, you can't just go streaming on in. And that's what we've got to look forward to over the next few months. All these things are going to start to develop and their behaviors are going to start to change. And isn't it amazing that some of you have watched the Karula's two cubs or her cubs over the last few years growing up and seeing their where they move to. I think that is very special. The most famous animals in the world. Hello, Cameron. So, Cameron wants to know, firstly I must say, Cameron, you are six. Welcome, I'm glad you're watching us and keep watching us. Now, Cameron, you're wanting to know, does the female cub, does the girl cub, ever get an opportunity to come through and eat and the kill in the tree? Yes, she does. However, we're not sure where she is at the moment. Possibly she's still full. Maybe she ate a little bit earlier. And that's what happens, is when there's food available, they don't have to eat at set times all the time. If you're feeding hungry, well, then you can get up and you can come and have something to eat. It's sort of like at home, Cameron, when you're feeling thirsty, I'm sure you just go to the fridge and you get some juice and you drink it, or you get some water. You don't always have to ask mom to do it for you. So that's exactly what happens with the leopard. So maybe she's eaten already and now she's sleeping. But unfortunately, the boys, they need to eat lots. Sort of like my brother. When my dad would do the grocery shopping and he'd come home, and you'd think he hadn't even been out yet to do the grocery shopping because he would have eaten everything. So Hosanna is a growing man. He needs to eat his fill so he can become big and strong like his dad. Oh, careful. Though as we're sitting here watching him, we're definitely seeing an improvement in him sort of balancing and able to pull and drag that carcass around. He's getting much better. So there's improvement every minute. But you see, he does get a bit excited every now and then and lose his footing. I just hope he doesn't fall, because luckily it's not too far away, so I suspect he will be fine. And I wonder if it's true with leopards and the other big cats, because I know domestic cats, they say they always land on their feet when they fall. Now, I wonder if that's true with the leopards. See, they're going, biting on the face now, sort of eating the cheeks, and then possibly moving on towards the neck. But you're going to have to pull the hair out there. Mom didn't do that for you. But perhaps because he's still young, he might just try and bite through it. Yes, he's being quite lazy. See how he's just going for the parts that are already stripped, although... You pulling any hair out of you, just biting through it and eating a bit of the hair. And now he's got it wrapped around another branch, so he's going to find it quite difficult to pull it around. But possibly it's a good strategy, because he's going to have a bit of leverage now. The carcass is not going to move around as easily as it was. It's wedged in quite nicely. I don't know if you can hear him crunching away. The wind is definitely picking up. We're even starting to feel a breeze now down in this drainage. And we weren't feeling a breath of wind earlier. wonder where Sean Gile is hiding. It would be nice if she came out. Reaching for the other side now. No, you've eaten that end already. There's nothing left there. I bet it must sound so quiet for all of you. Possibly you can hear the wind as it's gusting through here, and the odd orange-breasted bushrack calling coffee, tea, and me in the distance, and Hosanna crunching on some bones. Are you going to jump? What is your next move? I think he's confused because he has sort of tied this bushback in a knot. He's licking. I can't see what he's doing too well. He's chewing some part of the bushback now. We haven't seen him get too many big chunks of meat off. Oh! He ripped something open. They've actually eaten quite a large portion of this bushback. Now that it's been turned around quite a bit, you can see it a little bit better. Possibly they're going to finish it tonight and then move off by tomorrow morning. Hopefully they won't go too far, with Karula showing a little bit of interest like she did in those Inyala. That's a great sign. Maybe something like that happens again and then she'll actually make an attempt and try and kill something. It's a nice tree to stash a kill in. Out of the wind, good fork in it to wedge whatever she may catch. As we can see, she's wedged this bushbuck in it nicely, and nice horizontal branches, so there is nice a lot of space for them to move around on and feed off of, and great for us because there's not lots of branches in the way too. That's just amazing. That light is just getting better and better by the minute. What are you eating? The neck? No, it's a leg. Lots of meat there. Come on, use your paws, hold it down, and then cool. That meat looks nice and soft, but his teeth aren't as big and strong as Mom's teeth are just yet. They're still tiny in comparison, as you can see every now and then when he opens his mouth. I suppose it's a little bit more difficult to pull any flesh off, but look at that. There we go. That's a great, great amount of meat there. Trying that carnassial shear, not quite getting it right. See the little teeth there? Very small. We've got lots of growing to do. So Atif was wondering this afternoon which the cats are the most dominant between a cheetah, a leopard, and a jaguar. Now, unfortunately, Atif, we don't get any jaguar in this part of the world. However, jaguars are slightly larger than leopards. So in terms of who is bigger and stronger, it would have to be a jaguar. But here in Africa, out of the two that you mentioned, the cheetah and the leopard, I'd have to say the leopard. But if you are comparing all the big cats that we have here in Africa, the lion definitely wins. The lion is definitely the king of the savannah and bush. Much larger. They also live in family groups. They live in prides. And they're the only sociable cat in the world, which makes them so successful. Leopards, cheetah, jaguars, tigers, they're all solitary. And obviously, it's quite difficult if you don't have others to help defend you or help hunt. Life is very tough. You're constantly looking over your shoulder and you've got no one else to help you look around and look for potential danger. Here we go, finally got through to some good chunks, but still struggling. Karula would be eating this with ease. Smell it again now. Really beautiful light. I can't resist taking one more photo. Seems as if it's the first time I've seen these lovely leopards, this leopard cub. But I wish you would look at me again. You've got to be so quick to get the right moment. Just catching that lovely light as it hits Hosanna's eyes. Now we're unfortunately not going to be able to stay here forever, as much as I would love to sit here for the entire afternoon. I know that there are some other guides that would like to come and see Karula and her lovely cubs, but we can probably sit here for a little bit more longer. He seems very comfortable in this tree now, which is good. A little bit of blood smudged on his cheeks that he'll have to clean a little bit later. That's also one thing, if you notice the difference of when lions are feeding versus when the leopards are feeding. I find that the leopards seem to be a little bit more cleaner and a little bit more delicate when they feast. They get a little bit of blood on their paws and around their face. But when a lion eats, oh my goodness, they stick their heads in the carcass, they're covered in all the feces, they get so dirty. Sometimes it's hard to tell the difference between the ground, and if there's little cubs, then they blend in so well. I just want to quickly answer Mike, everybody. Mike, you're more than welcome to make your approach down here. So I think that's quite nice, the difference. Sort of leopards being a little bit more graceful when they feed versus those messy lions. Though when it comes to the best scene and photographic opportunities, it's always nice seeing a lion feasting when they stick their heads out and their entire head is covered in blood. That's quite special. You've gone very quiet now. Obviously found another nice little bit of flesh and wedged himself in quite well. Do you think you could eat like that, hanging from a tree with your feet standing on either side of a branch, wedging themselves in? I don't think I could. I think that it's quite phenomenal how they're able to do all of this. Right, we're going to have to unfortunately leave these lovely leopards, and while I try and navigate out of this thick drainage area, let's see how a Brent is doing and if he's still on cheetah plains.
But apart from a slight squiz at Mr. Q, the cheetah plains was quite barren, so we've started making our way back towards Juma, and hopefully those lions might still be around Buffleshook Waterhole, so we'll go have a look there. But remember, this is a live African safari. You've been seeing those leopards live with Taylor, and remember, questions at wildearth.tv or hashtag safarilive on Twitter if you've got any questions or wonderings or musings about the magical African wildlife. Yeah. I'd like to join you there. Copy, no problem. I'm still about 7 or 8 minutes away. Okay, so it sounds like those lions are still at Buffalo's Hook Dam, so we're going to start toddling along in that direction. Oh, that is quite pretty. What do you think, Chandra? Is it worth it? I think so. So you can see this really strange light. It's almost quite eerie. And there you go. Look at that. Isn't that pretty? Minus the electricity poles, yes. Yes, that's why we have to zoom in above the poles. Right, we're going to keep toddling on. Now, of course, I know a lot of you will be ecstatic to know that Commander Bond will be back tomorrow. Yes, I think it's tomorrow. Wait, what day are we? Are we Thursday or Wednesday? See, the one thing about living out in the bush, we do lose track of days, dates, and things like that. Okay, so it's Wednesday, I hear. So, no, Bond will be back on Friday. But probably only on drive on Saturday. Now, Jason's asked a very interesting question. And have I ever heard of a king cheetah? And are there any on cheetah plains? Okay, now, strangely enough, of course I've heard of a king cheetah. Now, there's a car coming. Let me just get off the road. We don't cause traffic jams. There we go. Okay. So, king cheetah is a form of menilism. So, it's basically a color variation. And unfortunately, this is one of the pictures I have. Now, that is of a king cheetah skin. Now, you can see how the spots actually merge into stripes. Now, this area was actually quite famous for king cheetah. And that's one of the last king cheetah from the wild, and it was caught in Acorn Hook. Now, Acorn Hook is not far from where we're sitting right now. So there is a possibility that king cheetah genetics are still here in this area. They haven't been seen since the 70s, though. Now, what probably happened is that, because it was such an anomaly, those cheetah were actually caught and moved around, and they're at breeding centers and places like that. And it's not impossible that the genetic line still lies in this area, but it's more than likely that most of that little genetic variation have been moved out. But fingers crossed, you never know. We could always see a king cheetah. So, while we're trundling back towards Juma, there some other updates for you. Tundi still has 2 cubs, and apparently she's taken them into Torchwood. And Shadow, of course, has been mating with Tingana, so it's most likely that, unfortunately, her cub has moved on to the next plane. There you go. Hello people, goodbye people. And what other cat reports can I give you? Oh, Inchila has been popping up and around all over the place. Last I heard, she was very close to Juma on the boundary with Sibambili at One Eye Pan. She had a kill there, but I didn't hear anything more today. That was yesterday. I think that's about all the cat updates I've got for you at the moment. It was quite funny when we saw quarantine. DeAndre says to me, oh, have you heard about quarantine? And I said, well, no, DeAndre, I actually have no idea about quarantine. And literally as he said that, I heard on the radio that he'd killed the reed buck. Now, we are about to go through the Mulwanini, which is another one of the little dry riverbeds. And fortunately, there's a whole tribe of gremlins live at the bottom of the Mulwaneni. So we often lose signal as we cross through. So to avoid you having that dastardly gremlin interference, let's go see how Taylor's doing.
We made it out of that treacherous drainage line, safe and sound, no holes in the tires, not yet, which is good for us. And I think we got a fantastic sighting, and I'm hoping that all the other guests that get to come and have a look at that get to have as great of a sighting as we did. We were very spoiled. It's nice to see how Karula woke up the entire process. That's my favorite thing. That's how I like to see it happen slowly and not just get there when the action is all happening. You need time to prepare for these things. So it was perfect timing this afternoon. Let's see who we've got flying in the distance. I can't really see. Looks very big. I wonder if it's not a Marshall Eagle. It's far away, and I did just see a lot of white. Yes. It looks as though it could be a Marshall Eagle, everybody, flying around like that. I just need to chat to Mike very quickly. Go, Mike. Off it goes. Big negative. You carry on shortcut Gallagher. You take the second shortcut that goes towards the cut line. You go along that Ndlela, you will see that there is a very prominent two track running south. And then you drive on that for quite some time, but you'll eventually get to the big dip again. Just guiding Mike into the sighting. That was quite nice, a Marshall Eagle soaring in the distance. Well, Jenna's asking something quite hysterical. So Jenna wanted to know, how on earth am I finding my way around the reserve? Well, Jenna, with a great difficulty. You get to learn the roads quite easily once you've worked on more than one reserve before, which obviously makes it a little bit easier. I find that the first reserve you work on, those roads are the hardest roads to learn, just because you're very unsure of how to navigate through the bush. You don't realize how important landmarks are. So trees, big termite mounds. There's no road signs out here, I'm afraid. So I was very fortunate enough to be given a map. That's typically what happens. And then you learn the map off by heart, really. The more and more you drive the roads, the better you get. And I'm getting there. I know Duma now, all right. I'm going to show you the little magpie shrike. Struggling to hold on in the wind. But once I've mastered cheetah planes and Arethusa, I'll get there eventually. I'll be very happy, and off they go. There's another one still over there. Little magpie shrike. I don't know if you can see, there's two of them that sat down there. They're very gregarious birds. You often see them in groups together. And their tails make a very good windsock. And they're able to also tell you which direction the wind is blowing in. There were a couple of buffalo weavers hanging around too. Now, I used to like buffalo weavers. And the reason why I say used to is because there's a pair that is building a nest right outside my bedroom window. And David is smiling because he knows exactly what I'm talking about. It's almost like a smile and a head shake at the same time. Now, this pair is building a nest in an acacia xanthiflora, so a fever tree. And every morning as that sun comes up, you hear them chatting away, and they don't stop building. So that might be actually something that we'll have to try and show you some photos of. So I'll try and get some photos of their nest and how well they're going. But I just wish they wouldn't build it outside my window, or at least be quiet if you are having a morning to sleep in. When you're driving first thing in the morning, it's not a problem. It's actually a great alarm system. No, actually, we beat them. We get up before the sun comes up. We beat them a little bit, but it can be a bit pesky and a bit frustrating at times. And they don't stop. They go the whole day as well. They're very, very busy, hard workers. It's very windy, everybody. Feels like I'm in a, I don't know, a tunnel of wind at the moment. I'm trying to hold on my cap. I actually have to pull it down, so I apologize if you hear a noise. Just so that it stays on my head and it doesn't hit anybody in the face. I see quite a few impala jumping around up in the distance, so we're going to make our way towards those impala and see what they are going and racing around for. Possibly the wind, maybe one just got a fright, but we'll go and investigate now. Just taking our time as we get there. We're in no rush, we're on safari. We get to just bumble around and see the most amazing things. We're almost there. I feel like I'm going to have to put a safety belt on David. Not because of my driving, but because the wind is so strong. He's holding onto the camera for dear life. Ooh. Right, I can slowly start to see the impala bums. Oh yeah, there's lots of impala. A lovely breeding herd. Now what were you all running around for? Let's see who's going to stand still for the camera. Those ones are, but let's go up a little bit further just because I see a really nice group just up ahead and they all bundled together, which is quite nice. I'm going to go try and go as quietly as I can. Possibly the wind is going to muffle the sound of the vehicle that they're looking at me now, so I suspect that I've been spotted. Hello everybody, and there's a nice mixture. Lots of females, lots of young males. Ooh. Oh no. Hello young boy. There's one there. So everybody, we're on a bit of an incline. Here's the young male that I was talking about. It's a really big herd. They're on either side of the road. Ooh, let's see if we can get them, everybody, dashing across the road. Because normally, here we go, they're going to start. Watch. Try and get a screenshot of them leaping across. Normally that one goes, they all go. There they go. Whee! Come on, do a big jump for us. These are the long distance jumping champions. I know I've said this before, but now we can actually see. They can leap a length of 10 meters. Here comes a big male and a female. Who's going to get it? Whee! No one's doing any big jumps. Here, there's some more come. Racing across. Oh, come on. Woo! Did you see that? That's the winner, everybody. I don't know who that was, but that was definitely the winner. What should we call her? Should we call her Cynthia? The Impala wins the race today. And, oh no, we've got one more contender coming. Come on, can you beat Cynthia? No, that was quite a pathetic attempt. So, no. Cynthia wins the high jumping competition today. It was quite funny. I think it was just off screen. Ooh. Sorry, I don't know. Wendy's doing some interesting things and has been doing. I think there's some gremlins living in Wendy at the moment. Occasionally she just decides that she likes to stop even though you don't have your foot on the brake or anything. It's okay. Don't worry. We'll have to get the mechanics to have a look at her. You'll be okay for today, we promise you. You've got petrol in you, so don't worry. Just patting Wendy for encouragement. Sometimes you need to talk to them quite nicely. That was a lovely show that the Impala very quickly put on for us. Are we going to carry on? Now, I don't particularly have any plans for us this afternoon. I thought we would just do a little bit of a bumble after we had such a special show with Karula. She was my only plan this afternoon. Now we're just going to see what else we can bump into. So maybe we will check Bubbles Hook Dam and we'll have a quick little look around there. Perhaps go down Hyena Road. Ah, okay, no, we're not going to go there. I think Brent is going there. We'll go somewhere else. Let's go down. Oh, we've got some more impala. Another big herd. There's lots of them again. See, they're all a little bit stirred, these impala. It's like I said, it's the wind. It's affecting their behavior quite a bit. And this is quite nice. You can see all that lovely green grass that's come through. It's growing quite quickly. But unfortunately, I think it's reached its maximum length. And Donna, welcome back. And O'Donnell, you've said you haven't been able to watch the show for some time, and you've noticed all this lovely green grass. Now, Donna, we had some rain while you were away, about a week and a bit ago. We had about 36 mils of rain that came showering down on us. It was fantastic. I was very frightened, though, because of the big thunderstorm. It was pretty. It was beautiful. But it did scare me. I couldn't sleep that night. And that is why you see all this lovely green grass. And you can see that the impala are a lot happier. Some of them were starting to look a little bit thin. But now they've all sort of fattened up quite nicely. And it's perfect timing as well. But they've managed to we've managed to have that little downpour, just so that all these female impala that are pregnant, you can see a lot of them are quite round, but they do get a little bit of food, a little bit of nutrients for their unborn babies. They're very, very unsettled. They keep moving away, looking towards us. Some of them dart off. The lovely big male, he's looking at us now. Yes, don't worry, we're not interested in your ladies. We're just watching you. Look at the, look, oh, I don't know if we're gonna get them. Straight in front. Oh, I mean, I'm wondering if some more are going to come through, everybody. Sorry, I gave David a bit of a fright. But a group of impala very quickly dashed across the road, and I thought that because it was a group, that possibly some more were going to come running out like what we just saw. So I thought we better have a look just in case we see any more jumping, and perhaps somebody jumps higher than Cynthia. Ooh, come on, Wendy, you can do it. Well, as we continue down the Bubbles Hook cut line, maybe I'm going to bump into Brent. Let's see if he's managed to find his way out of that particular tricky spot. Ah, okay. Everybody have a look at this. Can you see all the lion tracks? Look at all these wonderful lion tracks that we found, everyone. Well, it's hard, it's a little bit difficult to see, but that's a big male footprint that you can see there. There's lots and lots of them there. So perhaps they were walking along here at some point today. Some of them look like they are from maybe after game drive this morning. They look to be on top of some of the tire tracks, which is quite nice. And I know now that Brent is possibly going to be following up on those lines. So we're not going to head to them. Right. Finally, as we speak of male lions, Brent has got one for you.
And they haven't moved much from where we first found them this morning. I think they've moved out of the thicket as it's got a bit cooler, and they're lying out on the wind. And it is quite windy where we are. Oh, listen. Females contact calling, and if you hear any kids, not to worry, it's just Mike and Candace from Juma. Oh. Sorry, he got a fright from something that flew into his hole in the face, and he literally leapt up. Shame, big boy. He's battling with those flies. Back to sleep. So, as I said, Mike and Candace and their kids are out on drive. So, what an awesome way to grow up. Just like I did from a very young age, sitting on the back of a game drive vehicle. Here we go. Look at that. It's quite chilly. The temperature's dropped quite a bit in the last little while. And now as the light gets lower, you can really see that lighter color under a lion's eyes. And it helps them collect all the ambient light at night for hunting. Hi, Daniel. Daniel in Scotland is wondering how far can a lion's roar travel. Now, all depends on wind direction and cloud, and whether it's day or night, but from a human point of view, you can possibly just hear lions at about 10 kilometers if you've got shame. If you've got shame. Poor dude. If you've got good hearing. But from a lion's point of view, you can probably hear him from about 20 k's. He can't wait for that to heal. Is that some booty leaf on his leg there? Or is that another hole? It's another hole. Why aren't you just full of holes, mister? So I'm trying to get a little bit closer to it and get parallel to him. Oh, he's going to stand up and move, of course. Oh, look at that. I love that when you get that, the wind-swept mane. Isn't that gorgeous? Don't rub your hole on me. Massive gape. Oh, what has she seen? Honestly, she looks like she's looking quite intently. Let's see if I can see over the wall. Is there other lions on their way back, or is there a possible hunt about to happen? Definitely noticed something. No, not that interesting. Okay, let's move back a little bit to be parallel with him. Hey, big boy. How's that for you, Gendre? So, Judy in California says, is it just me or is the swelling getting worse? Now, Judy, I think it's actually gone down a bit. So, 2-3 days ago, he was battling to open his eye, but now he can open the eye quite fully, so his swelling has gone down a little bit. Shame, Mr. Fat Cheek. There are still maggots in there. Okay, sorry, I'm just gonna try. There are still a few maggots in there. And see, there's a fly. Oh no, there's maggots inside still. Now guys, I know for sensitive viewers this can be a little bit graphic, but it is what happens out here in the bush. So there are still maggots inside that wound and are feeding off the flesh. Now in some cases, there we go, you can see one there, they can be sometimes a little bit helpful. if there is any rotten flesh, they can feed off it, but other fly species will eat off living flesh, and that for me definitely doesn't look like rotten flesh that they're eating. Shame, big boy. Said it was easy being a male lion. It is tough at the top. See some blood dripping out of the wound. Now the great mystery as to which fly species that is. I'm pretty certain it's possibly one of the blowflies. She's seen something or possibly even heard something. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to go forward and we'll just pop ourselves up on top of the wall and maybe see what she's saying, or she might have heard something in the distance. Oh, she's going back to sleep. I'm just going to give Aubrey a bit of space to come and have a look as well. Jeffrey, I'm trying to think of what to say to this. So Jeffrey in Texas says, please can we name this Birmingham boy Fleur de Fort after the largest crater, asteroid impact crater in the world, which is in South Africa, due to the large crater in his face. Well, Jeffrey, I don't know. I can't see why not. What do you think, Chandra? Chandra is non-committal. Let's put it to a vote. Who thinks we should call him Fleur de Fort with the large crater in his face? Look at the lines now.
And also, I want to talk about the
sleepy kitty. I'm actually going to get my camera out in case she opens her eyes. I think that'll make quite a nice photograph. So I hope you guys get some screenshots of that beautiful young Inkahuma lady. I just got to wait for her to open her eyes more. Remember to share your screenshots on our Facebook page or on Twitter with the hashtag SafariLive. I think the rest of the pride is further to the west of us from the tracks that I saw this morning. And we're in the myriad of drainage lines and thickets near Gowrie Cutline. hopefully they'll come out overnight and we'll be able to find them in the morning. And we're just waiting for her to open her eyes ever so well. Okay, so we're going to sit here. Hopefully these lions get moving or get busy, one of the two. But while we do that, let's go back to Taylor, who's got an exquisite African sunset to show you.
That is the sun that you are looking at, and isn't it beautiful? It disappeared behind some clouds, but it has now found a little gap for us to have a look. And it's going to disappear again behind another set of clouds, and then I don't think we will see any more of it, I'm afraid. But I'm very, very happy to see all the build-up of clouds at the moment. There's some really nice ones, but I want to take you away from the clouds where the sun is, and I want to draw your attention a little bit further south. So, where that, should we go a little bit further to the right, where that dead tree is? That big tree? Oh, a little bit further to the left, sorry! Oh, my bad, everybody. I don't know my left and rights today. Now, I don't know if you can see those clouds forming on the top of the tree there. Now, they're slowly, very, very slowly turning into cumulonimbus clouds, especially on the right-hand side there. And those are the clouds that we want to see. They're going to start to form and spread vertically, and then hopefully horizontally as well. And maybe we'll start to see some lightning. You can actually see some more little ones forming. There's two over there. They're very small now, but hopefully they're going to merge with one another. And we see those big sort of anvil shapes, the cumulonimbus clouds start to form. And now we need the entire sky to fill up with all those clouds and get a big thunderstorm. The temperature's dropped a whole lot now. It is very chilly. David was laughing at me because I said that I'm not going to need a jacket today. And rookie error it was. It is getting a little bit chilly. How beautiful is that? That is so special. So that this wind, perhaps it is going to blow more of the clouds in and keep bringing that cold weather. And then we're going to get some more rain. But at the moment, there's too much blue sky. I don't think we're going to get rain this evening. I think that we're going to get lots and lots of rain. I'm just about lying down. Lots of rain, maybe tomorrow. Well, I'm hoping. Cross your fingers, cross your toes, do the rain dances, do whatever you need to do. But please help us try and get some rain for the next few days. And if we do, these little gaps that you're seeing of all the grass, you can see there's obviously a lovely layer of green, but there's quite a few patches. And if we do get some more rain, that rain will allow those roots to be able to spread a little bit further and sprout some growth on top of the surface. And then we'll have a lovely carpet of green. There'll be no white at all. And then possibly the grass will grow to about that long. At the moment, it's sort of only growing about the length of my hand. And that's it. Sorry, my hands are now very dirty, everybody, for patting Wendy and trying to encourage her to not break down on us this afternoon. So we still haven't decided on what we're doing. Oh no, come on Wendy! That was close. Just wondering if she's going to hold up on us. I'm perhaps going to have to keep her running. It's okay, you'll be fine. She's older. Don't let her hear you say that. Otherwise we'll be in a bit of trouble. We're going to go and check a few watering holes just to have a look and see if anything's decided to come down and perhaps quench their thirst after this hot day that we've had. It should be nice, but it's a bit windy, like I said, so I'm not sure if everybody's also hiding, so a bit of a catch-22, but we shall try. And while I make my way towards a treehouse dam and a few others, let's see if those Nkuhumas have decided to start moving yet.
Not much happening. She's just given a few contact calls and changed her position quickly. That's also quite a nice screenshot there. But pretending to be a termite mound. Now, she was contact calling in the direction she's facing, and that is to the west, where I think possibly the rest of the pride might be in one of these impenetrable thickets. She's probably going to try to give this guy the slip at some point. And I definitely think their honeymoon is over, so to speak. Although he looks to still be feeling a little amorous. He's got nice fluffy hair from all the wind. Even with a hole in his schnoz, he's a good-looking boy. Now, of course, this is coming towards the end of their mating. It hasn't ended. It's about to. And Ellen was wondering, how do they know when the estrus cycle is over? Well, generally, she'll just stop flirting with him and start becoming quite aggressive towards him if he does try to be amorous. But male lions need a few good smacks before they really catch the hint. So he'll follow around and irritate her normally for sometimes a day after the mating's ended. Unless there's a call to arms by one of the other coalition members. Okay, well, I think we're going to get some really good screenshots if I pop down and we get right opposite her. Look into those gorgeous eyes. Say when, Jean-André. Here we go. Isn't that spectacular? Come on, open your eyes. It's photo time. Do you want the light? Yes?
Yeah.
Cool. I always love watching a lion's eyes when they're sort of half dozing, half awake, and they sort of slowly, slowly close. Now see, they open again a little bit. Heavy. Oh no, waking up a little bit again. Now, one of the reasons they've probably moved up and out into the open on the dam wall with the strong wind is because of the flies. So this wind will keep some of the flies at bay, of course not all of them, as you can see there. Spots on her nose. Now, some cases, as she gets older, that nose will darken. But I have seen in other cases that lions' noses don't darken as they get older, and they stay pink. It's quite magic sitting this close to Africa's biggest cat. We're about 7 or 8 feet. Oh, bite that fly. You get him. See, she might try contact call again. Wind is actually getting stronger. Answering me. Why? Where are you? Oh, shame. I don't think there's going to be too much movement from these big cats. Oh, there's a long-tailed shrike in the background. And that dizzy fuss, there's a couple of them actually. And you can see how strong the wind is just from how that shrike is battling to balance. And then in the big torchwood above and beyond, some noisy buffalo weavers working on their communal nests. Those nests are impenetrable. Look, there we go. There's one threading in a nice thorny branch. Getting ready to keep the ladies happy come laying time. There you go, see, that's quite early in construction. It's getting the frame right. Now, of course, the best real estate is in the center of those nests. The guy building on the left, you know, that's new suburb, undeveloped yet. He's in the what's it there? Speculative market, and he's hoping that by building there on the edge, it's going to become the middle one day, and someone else will build next to him, and he'll be in a better prime spot to attract the females. The wind is getting stronger and stronger. So it is getting cooler. And I've got a hunch that we might find the rest of the Nkuhumas around Gowrie Cutline. So I think we're going to leave these two for now and make our way to see if we can find the rest of the pride. It really doesn't look like they're going to move anytime soon. Bye, YouTube. A And while we go in search of the rest of the Nkuhumas, let's go see how Taylor's faring.
It's very, very windy. It's getting very cold now. I'm about to go and make myself a jersey out of leaves or something like that. It's getting so cold. But I see that David is braving it out with me.
No, I don't have my jacket.
Oh, David doesn't have his jacket either. So we're both going to freeze to death, everyone. So hopefully it doesn't get too much colder than what it already is. That'd actually be quite interesting. Maybe Louise, could you find out what the temperature is now? So I believe it was about 83 degrees Fahrenheit when we started this afternoon. And I suspect it's probably dropped to about... Let's see. It cannot. I do not believe that for 1 second. So Louise, let me know now, just in my little earpiece over here, that it is 80 degrees Fahrenheit. I cannot believe that. It cannot be 27 degrees Celsius. It is a lot more cold than that. Louise, your thermometer is broken. You need to get another one. Because we're sitting here, I'm about to start rubbing my arms vigorously to try and keep warm. Now, everything else has also run away from us. Even the impala have all fluffed up a bit and moved on into the thicker vegetation. But maybe it's a bit chilly because we're actually on the move. We've got a lot of wind blowing towards us, so there's quite a chill factor that comes with the wind as well. So that's probably it, while everybody sits inside with their lovely warm jerseys. I wonder if Brent was clever enough to bring a jacket out this afternoon. But David, we've learned our lesson, haven't we? We've learned our lesson. We'll never leave a jacket behind, no matter how hot it is. So we're still slowly making our way towards the dam. I got distracted. I was talking and looking for animals and things, and then I forgot to take the right turn. So we're going the scenic way around at the moment, but we'll get there eventually. And I was hoping the weather was going to stay nice and warm, because then we would have been able to have looked for some frogs. But I don't think there's any chance of frogs with this chilly weather. All the insects, I think the beetles, the scorpions, they're all going to hide away, stay in their leaf litter under the bark. I don't think there's any need for them to come out tonight. But we're getting there slowly. The only thing that is around at the moment is, we've got another update from Louise. So Louise says it's actually 77 degrees Fahrenheit, so it's a little bit colder, but it still feels much colder than that. But when you stop, it's not so bad. But then I have to put my foot on the accelerator, and then we get that wind again. So I'm taking wrong turns. I obviously don't know this part of Duma very well just yet. So Jenna, remember you were asking me earlier about how I get away around? Dave. Dave helps me, and whoever else is working the camera, and then occasionally I have to bring out my phone as well and put the GPS on and then use the Google Maps and whatever it may be and try and find my way around there. Right. While I fix this little roadblock, I think I heard correctly, but I think you're heading over to Brent now.
Yeah, we've got some magnificent kudu bulls. And that one on the left with that magnificent spread. I'm sure he just placed his horn. So there's some females around, and I wonder if one of them isn't coming into estrus. And he's putting mud on his horns to make himself more impressive to the ladies and more intimidating to the other bulls. Now, we've been noticing some interesting behavior from the kudu bulls. There we go, look at that. Now, I've seen them about 3 or 4 times in the last week using their horns to break branches down to an easier height to eat. It looked like you might do that there for a second. Oh, and gave him a fright. The that was. Just suddenly scampered off. There's still some females at the back. Maybe it's just this really bustly, windy weather. And the lions have been around this area a lot, so there could be scent of lions around. But it's, speaking of this, the scent of the lions, we're going on our gut, and I think Linkuma's over there. So I'm going to go check. Listen for a second, although it's difficult in the wind. I put my shkogo. Ah, there is my shkogo. All this wind sending my mane flying about. Left eye, 101.10 guy, lying up, still on Buffalo's Hook Dam Wall. So, the last tracks I had of the Pride were going in here, and I'm hoping that while it's cooler, they might pop out on the other side. Now, whether they go to that buffalo that was killed by Amber Eyes and a single lion, male lion on Buffalo's Hook, or whether they've got another kill already, or if not, tonight's going to be prime hunting weather for them. Windy, cloudy, there's quite a few vultures about. We'll get a good view of them from the other side. Oh, excuse me, like the hiccups, where do those come from? Let's just let young, there we go, there goes one of those vultures I was just mentioning. Might be worth, it's a bit late now, but it might be worth taking a walk in here tomorrow morning. Hello, hello Michael.
Yeah.
Very well, and yourself? Did you go check on that carcass in Buffalo's Hook? Not today. Okay. No problem. Enjoy, guys. Okay, let's move on. See what else we can find. Oh, James Richard. He's quite excited about the thought of all the butterflies we're going to see soon. Jandre, of course, is not. Static butterflies, he says, only static butterflies. And James Richard is wondering what, as I said, is the top of the butterfly species I'd like to get on camera this year. Well, any new one. So I think we are sitting on about 20-odd species so far that we've managed to get on camera. And of course my favorite family on butterflies is the acrias. I think we've got about four different acrias on camera. We've got the African monarch, we've got diadem so far. We've got two species of blues, yet unidentified to the individual species. We've got guinea fowl, we've got yellow pansy, blue pansy, ox-eyed pansy. So we're on 13 so far. What else am I forgetting on the butterfly front? Ah, the joker, 14. I know I'm missing a few. Oh, brown-veined white, broad-banded grass yellow, African vagrant. So we're around 20 that we've got on camera, so you need to add to that list. And of course, just in case everyone forgot over the dry season, to reacquaint ourselves with the butterflies that we've already got as well. I'm just excited for butterflies in general. Now, as I said, I think the lions are in this area, and I'm just all the rest of the Inkahumas with the cubs. I'm hoping that if it gets cooler, they might pop out. Now, I'm going to just ask if anyone's checked on that buffalo carcass that is in Buffalo's Hook. stations. Did anyone check on that Nyari carcass in Buffalo's Hook today?
Wait for a honkfa.
Copy, were there any Angara on that carcass? Standing by? Copy, thanks very much. The last recons I had of the whole pride were going from Hyena Road into those Shkovas between Gari Katlan. I'm checking Gari Katlan down towards Central now. Okay, so apparently only vultures, so they abandoned an almost a full buffalo. I wonder where they are. Or have they got another buffalo in the block? They are the incredible Nkumas after all. I wonder if this wind is going to bring rain. I don't know. I don't know just yet. What do you think, Chandra? While we ponder the upcoming weather, and let's go see what Taylor's been pondering.
So we went to the wonderful Treehouse Dam, and unfortunately there was nothing there, just a little bit of water, but we've got some more puddles, as you can see, little puddles here, but it doesn't seem like there are any frogs or any life in here, just a couple of leaves. And while we were sitting at Treehouse Dam, we did hear some elephants screeching. Now that's what we're looking for. I thought that if we could possibly find them, maybe we could put the infrared on and have a look at them like that. But we haven't found them yet. So I'm waiting till I hear a little scream of obviously a young elephant that wants to suckle. That's what it sounded like, and Mom was refusing. But nothing just yet, so we're looking. But it's also getting to that awkward time of the day where the sun is not out anymore and there's just a little bit of light left. And it's playing lots of tricks on my eyes because I've spotted all sorts of goodies that have turned out to be logs or trees or shrubs. So I hope we don't do any more of that. Doesn't seem to be anything happening here. Isn't this, David, where we had all that action?
Yes.
Oh, this is where Chele Pan.
Correct.
Ah, so now I know where we're going. Let's go down this way. I don't know, for a little giggle, let's go around here. I'm going to lose my hat at some point. It keeps wanting to blow straight off of the top of my head. Now I can just see lots and lots and lots of elephant footprints going that way, in all the directions. So hopefully we're going to come across one. This is sort of where it sounded like they were shouting from. But nothing just yet. And the clouds have definitely come over this evening. We actually have a look. There's not very much sky around anymore. It's very dark and gloomy this evening. You see all that grey sky coming in, which is fantastic for us. We just need to build up a layer, and then we can work on the cumulonimbus clouds to come through. Now, I don't know where I'm going. I'm just driving now, hoping to find us something to look at. Also listening out for any of the scops owls, or perhaps the last calls of the pearl-breasted. Maybe we get to see one of those, though with the wind I think the birds could be struggling to hold on to their perch, like we saw those magpie shrikes earlier, how their tails were sort of moving around quite a bit. Here we go, we're going in and down towards the Muwati. Or somebody was shouting. Who's shouting here? Drongo. Drongo, what are you shouting at? Oh, we've got some Inyala though. You're not shouting. I don't think they're shouting at the Inyala. Let's come around here. Let's go stealth mode. There are the Nyala. Sorry, everybody. I parked on a bit of the slope, but it was the only way that we could see them. Because there's lots of trees. But they're moving out from the Muwati and they're coming up and feeding along this little drainage thicket. Very hard to see that those are actually Impala with the fading light. It's a bit too light still to put the infrared on. Let me go forward. Maybe we can get a shot of this drongo that is making lots of noise. No, don't fly. Just flew straight past us, unfortunately, and off he goes. He's shouting. He's unhappy about something. Come on, Wendy. Still going on. Perhaps he's just declaring his territory to everyone else. Oh, look what the elephants left us. Let me quickly pick up this root, everybody. I don't have to go too far. Yeah. I can even still stay connected, so I don't have to hold my breath, but I have to stay close. Oh, it's a bit longer than I thought. Now, this is actually some evidence that the elephants were here, as you can see. And now, if you look over here, the root where they've actually been chewing on it, it's still wet. So it's most likely not too old. They're perhaps munching on here just maybe an hour ago or so. But they pulled it right out of the ground, and unfortunately this is not going to live. Though I suppose if I planted it into the ground, it should be alright. You can see they munched on quite a few of the roots, and they didn't eat any of the leaves. Obviously wasn't too tasty. Off you go, tree. Now I need to climb it. Now my hands are really dirty. Very dirty. And I also just wanted to move that off the road, so it doesn't become an obstruction. That drongo is very unhappy. I don't know why it is so unhappy this evening. Oh, I'm coming apart, everybody. Please bear with me. My mic pack just fell out of my pocket. Okay, I'm in and I'm ready to go. Wendy, Wendy's not. Come on, Wendy. You can do it. You rev her like a race car every now and then. But she'll be alright. She'll make it. Right, is it time for lights? It could possibly be time for lights. Ooh. Right, as we trumble along here, it would be nice to hear some of your questions. We just want to have a little chat. You're welcome to either hashtag SafariLive with anything that you'd like to know, or you can also ask us on an email. You're still emailing, which is questions@wildearths.tv. And I know Ashley Stevens, thank you for your question. You'd like to know, with the wild dogs this morning that killed that Nyala lamb, will that female come into estrus again quite early? Now, I reckon so, Ashley. I think she will. Possibly because I believe it was quite a young Nyala. And I have seen Nyala giving birth all year round. I've seen lambs at the most bizarre times of the year. So I reckon that she will. She will make a gentleman very happy coming in at a strange time. So possibly she was very unfortunate for that female, but she also won't risk her life completely, knowing that she can have another fawn again. So, well, it's sad, it's life, but you're lucky you got to see wild dogs make a kill. That's quite special. I've only seen a handful of those in my life. Right, I think it's time for the spotlight now. It's almost there. It's very awkward. Oh, the spotlight is working. But while I carry on looking for chameleons and owls and all sorts of other things, let's go to Brent for an update.
Well, it seems like we have a very similar plan. Owls, chameleons and bush babies, and I've got one extra on my list. Frogs. But again, it seems when you go looking for frogs, it's windy, which is not great frogging weather. Now, I wonder who's going to be the first to spot the first chameleon after the rains. I was searching with very, very much intent. Oh, you see that through the light, through the bush there, Jean-Ré. You know what that is. It's a tailor. Yes, you can see, we can see our vehicles by the lights that are on them. There goes Taylor. Now, who is going to be the first to find a bush baby? I mean, a chameleon. Bush babies, I'm sure we'll find. Maybe, well, they might be, stay inside for a little bit longer in this windy weather. But I'm sure hunger will drive them out. Remember, we are live in the middle of the African bush. You can get hold of us and ask us questions using the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter, or use the email address questions@wildearth.tv. Hi, Bill. Now, Bill has caught me without my insect book, but I will try to explain it to the best of my ability. Now, Bill is wondering, what is the difference between a moth and a butterfly? Now, this is not always steadfast, but as a general rule, moths are nocturnal and butterflies are diurnal. So, moths are out at night and butterflies during the day. However, of course, there are exceptions. There are daylight moths and there are nocturnal butterflies. So, moving along. The main difference from a physiological point of view is their antennae. Now, if you look at their antennae, ooh, there's an owl. Something very slowly. Thought I saw an owl flash past us. Bill, I haven't forgotten. Don't worry. I'll explain now. I just want to see if we can. There he is, at the back. Now, who is it? I can see the false eyes staring at us. No? There he is. It's not what I thought it was. Those are his real eyes. There's a little African barred owlet by the looks of things. I just want to have a closer look, so I'm just trying to get this. Oh, yes. Hello, little guy. He's out hunting already. Well, off he goes. Maybe he saw something to pounce on. Oh, isn't that wonderful, little barred owlet? Oh, yeah, so, well, carrying on about moths and butterflies for Bill. So if you look at the antennae, even some of the moths have a very, very fine, but it's feathered. So there's little other bits coming off the antennae where there is a butterfly. It does not. It's a single with a bulb on the end. Now, also, butterflies almost exclusively feed on nectar. Now, they are attracted to strange things like buffalo urine and stuff from time to time to get moisture from. Moths mostly are nectar feeders, but you do have, sorry, bushbuck. Nice big male bushbuck. Unfortunately, it is. We don't shine our spotlights on the diurnal animals. So the reason for that is the spotlight can affect their eyes very briefly, but it might put them at a slight disadvantage for a short time. And of course, we're not here to interfere. We are here to observe. Now, the nocturnal animals, their eyes are designed differently, and they are able to withstand the spotlight without it affecting their eyesight at all. Now, this is always a good little chameleon spot as we come out of the Mawati. Check the gwarries carefully. No such luck there. Now, of course, there's apparently a missing male lion somewhere in this area. That's why I'm driving down here again as well. Oh, hello, Fran in England. Fran is building her safari life bird list and the Bard Outlet number 68. Well done, Fran. And guess what, Fran? I've started hearing a few of our migratory birds on their way back. I haven't managed to find one to put on camera yet. Of course, apart from the warbird's eagle. But today and yesterday, this morning I heard Class's cuckoo. And very exciting, before sunrise this morning, I heard the African cuckoo, the first one, which is quite early for it to be back. Cuckoo, cuckoo. Is it another one of those diker-like other animals? Or is it actually another animal? Can you give me a bit of a zoom in there, please, Chandra? Can you see? Eye there. Oh, that's a diker. That's a diker. Yeah. They're very good at being other animals. You always think they might be something else. They've got very wide set eyes for a little critter. I was hoping it might be a civet. This missing male lion. He just vanished. I think he actually got chased by elephants, so he should be around. So he might pop up on the Juma Dam cam, so keep an eye out. Hello, Zaki in Kenya. Nice to have you back with us, Zaki. Now, Zaki says, what is the best time for safari? Do we see more animals in the morning or in the evening? Well, Zaki, I would say probably about the same. So, it's the reason we go on safari in the early morning and in the late afternoon. It's because it's the two best times to see wonderful wildlife. So, during the heat of the day, most of your cats or predator species are going to be schnoozing and sleeping. You can still have fantastic elephants and other general game, but what a lot of people really love to look at is the cats. And that is the two best time of the day to view cats when they're most active. So I would say they're both great times to go on the safari. Oh, I thought that was a chameleon. Who is it going to be? Will it be Taylor? Or Jamie? Or Commander Bond? Now, David Ryan, hello David. Wondering, if you were to use a spotlight on a day animal, why do their eyes glow? Surely there shouldn't be. So you must realize their eyes are not like ours. So they still glow. They've still got the tapetum lucida. I always get that one a bit muddled up. So that reflective layer there. So you must remember, a lot of animals' eyesight isn't designed like ours. And even the daytime animals have better night vision than us. They have to protect themselves from the prowling predators of the night. So that is why they also will have better night vision, but not nearly to the degree of a lion or a leopard, for example. Come on, chameleons! So, speaking of chameleons, I've got a question for you. How many chameleon species do we get on Juma? If you know the answer, let me know. questions@wildearth.tv or #safarilive on Twitter. How many chameleon species occur in the Sabi Sands? Now, this is always a good little road for nocturnal creatures. And we're going to search carefully through here. While we do that, let's go see if Taylor's had any luck with the nocturnal critters.
Hello again. Now, this is a very, very good area for chameleons, everyone, so I'm just taking it very slow. And something that we're looking at, and I just want to remind all of you, is we're looking for a white reflection that comes off of it. Oh my goodness, what do we have over here? What on earth have we found, everybody? It's the first chameleon of the season. Brent, I've won. I beat Brent, everybody. I found the first chameleon. Now, this one looks a little bit sick, as you can see. It looks like it's got a bit of a thorn tree growing through its leg. And I'm not sure what type of species this chameleon is, unfortunately. It looks very much like a flap-neck chameleon. However, it also resembles a southern dwarf chameleon as well. Everybody, I win. I'm so excited. So maybe we should leave that for Brent and get him to come past. What do you think? What do we think? Louise, what do we think? Should we try and tell Brent to come through here and see if he spots it and see what his reaction is? Or have you already told him? We're trying to... Okay, no, we won't tease Brent. I think he's jealous that he didn't think of it first. Now, I need to rescue the chameleon, everyone, because I can't litter and I can't leave paper here, so I'm going to very quickly jump out. I'll just be just a moment. And I thought that was quite clever, seeing as Brent said he wanted to find the first one. Let me take my very sick chameleon off the tree. Now, I can't draw very well. This was a very quick an attempt at trying to draw a chameleon.
It was great.
Thanks. David said it was great. I think that's the first chameleon I've actually ever drawn, so I felt like as though the pressure was high. But I hope you enjoyed that, and I hope that just made you laugh a little bit. Seeing as we've been searching and searching for these chameleons over the last week, we're suspecting that they should start to come out shortly. So hopefully we will get one. How funny would it be if we actually managed to find one right now? That would be fantastic. Now, everyone, I'm only teasing Brent in case you're getting a bit worried. We all have a little bit of fun and a bit of banter with each other. It's awesome. It keeps us all strong and on our toes. Now, I don't know if you can see, there's lots of dust as well. So I'm going to definitely need a shower after this. Oh, what have we got up here? Who have we got? I wanted blind. We've got some impala. I'm going to have to dim my lights. That's right. So I'm wondering, should we go infrared? Should we do a little bit of infrared this evening? How do you feel, David? Good?
Yeah, we can.
Louise, do you feel good about doing a little bit of infrared this evening? Right. Are you ready for me? I'm switching off everything, turning off my lights. Off, spotlight is off. Right, we're going to approach these impala now. Hopefully they're not going to run away from us. We're just going to go quietly. Maybe they're not even there anymore. I can't see anything. It's very dark, so I'm looking at my monitor. Oh, no, I can sort of see the road still. Here they're impala. Look at all of them. Lots of them. They actually seem a lot more relaxed with us now than they are during the day. You can see there's someone shining their spotlight in the distance. Now, that's not because of us. A tree rustled because of the wind to the right of me, and now they're all panicked. So you can see how jumpy they become, not just because of the wind, but also because it's nighttime now and there's not a lot of starlight. There's actually no stars out, no moon tonight. It's very dark. So they're a little bit more panicky, and it's quite thick here, so they can't really see what's coming towards them. I think they're going to actually run off now. They're feeling a little bit nervous, but this is how they are. Perhaps they'll go to a nice open area and maybe have a little bit of a rest. But normally one or two of them will sort of stand up and keep watch, though there's no sort of set member of a herd that will stand and keep watch over them while they all rest. But remember, impala aren't having to chase after their food, so they don't use as much energy throughout the day, so they only need to sleep for a few hours, anywhere between 3 and 4 hours every single day. They take a siesta, an hour siesta during the heat of the day, and then at night they also sit down. But they don't sleep how we see the lions and the leopards sleeping. Right, I think we're going to let these impala be, and they are looking a little bit nervous, so don't want to upset them too much. But it was a fantastic afternoon, and I hope you all got some wonderful screenshots. But I'm going to have to say goodbye. So for myself and David, have a wonderful morning, and we'll both see you bright and early on the sunrise safari. But let's go over to Brent, and I'm sure he would like to say goodbye to you as well.
I've been checking one of my favorite chameleon trees, but alas, no chameleon, and well done to James, Richard, who got the answer spot on. There is only one chameleon species in the Sabi Sands, the flap-necked chameleon. We do not count paper chameleons, and yes, I think most chameleons need a heartbeat. Now, to resort to drawing a chameleon because you can't find one, that's a little sad, Taylor. But don't worry, maybe tomorrow night you will see one, or one of us will. So the race is on, it could be any of us. Who is going to see the first chameleon after the rains? Oh no, it's just a light colored leaf on there. I also checked my favorite bush baby spot. No luck there. Hi, Janet. Janet's wondering how many chameleon species we get in South Africa. Not many. I think it's about 5. I'm not 100% sure. I have to double check for you, Janet, but I know you've got a couple of dwarf chameleon species in the fynbos in around Cape Town and Namaqualand. And I think there might be a desert one. I'm trying to remember now. But I don't think too many. I mean, definitely less than 10. As we discussed a couple of nights ago, the place with the most chameleon species in the world is, of course, Madagascar. It's got more than half of the chameleons in the world. And after Madagascar is Tanzania. Now, I saw a few very cool chameleon species in Gabon. And the weirdest one I saw was called a Cameroon dwarf horn chameleon. It's tiny. And he had these long spikes on his nose that were about as long as he was. Very, very cool little thing, a little brown guy, but I mean, tiny, tiny little one. John Dre, have you seen any of the dwarf chameleons in the fynbos? In the Cape, yeah. So there's a couple of species, I think there's 3 or 4 maybe, and then flat-necked being the most widespread and common. But it looks like the chameleons are continuing to elude. Hopefully we start seeing some snakes as well, that'll be nice. But it has been a wonderful sunset safari with lions and with leopards, elephants. You know, one thing we haven't seen, I haven't seen in both drives today, was buffalo. I think Kahuma's keeping Juma quite buffalo free at the moment, and keeping very fat in the process. But from the whole of the Safari Live team, myself and Jean-André, it's not chameleon, it's a leaf. It was worth a try, but we'll see you bright and early with the sun rise safari. Bon week.